Okay, so for people watching in the future, this is an intro to Git class. Git is the thing we use a lot in PSAS, and that's how I got to use it. And now we're just at what is Git? So normally you'd like make a bunch of copies of your file and just save old versions of the thing you were working on. And if you wanted to like experiment with stuff, it would kind of suck if you did an experiment that ended up being useful that later on you wanted to use, or if you were collaborating with people and you were both trying to work on the same document and you were making changes to the same stuff and trying to figure out like whose changes do we keep, whose changes do we get rid of, stuff like that. Git is a way of managing all that garbage. Most of this is information you don't care about. So it was created to help with developing Linux because it was like a big piece of software that a lot of different people that weren't physically located together needed to work on, and needed to work on in like a distributed way. And what I mean by distributed is like because it was an open source project, you didn't have just a single list of everyone who was working on it. You could have some random person make changes to the code and then say, "Hey, you should use my changes," which if you're just editing files by themselves is kind of obnoxious to deal with, right? So this workshop will show you how to use Git and show you how to use a little bit of GitHub. They're different things. Git is the actual program that runs on your computer and the system for tracking versions. GitHub is an online cloud service thing, kind of like Google Drive or Dropbox, but specifically made for working with things that are tracked in Git. And there are similar softwares. You may have used one of these in the past. They accomplish a similar task in a different way, but we don't care about those right now. So everything in this workshop is going to be using Git from the command line, which will kind of suck if you've never used the command line before, but there's a very good reason for it. There's a whole bunch of different graphical tools for using Git, and they are all set up differently. And really, all they are is just like a pretty front end for running Git commands. Like, they aren't doing anything different from Git, and they pretty much are all just executing Git commands. But if you like go online and you look for help with your particular graphical tool, you need to get help from someone who also uses that tool. And you need to get help from someone who uses that tool in its current version, because they may have like moved around buttons or moved around the different menus. So if you learn how to do it on the command line, the help that you look for will always be the same. It's also like the most common way that people use Git, and it's the way that pretty much everyone at PSAS or like around PSU is going to use it. So it's a lot easier to get help if you're already working on the command line. Let's see, other bullet points that matter on here. So because we're working on the command line, there's going to be a little bit of the very, very raw basics of Bash, which is like the normal command line shell for Linux. And if you followed the recommendation on the email that got sent out to PSAS, you should have Git for Windows aka git-scm installed, and that comes with bash. And you know, we aren't gonna go into like advanced stuff for like how to do workflows in GitHub or like how to do really weird branching stuff in Git. If you're on Linux, you can type this command, man git everyday, and that'll give you a lot of really useful information. Or if you just Google that, you'll get the same thing and it's a lot of useful information. So hopefully we don't need to worry about installing stuff, since it sounds like pretty much everyone's good to go. If you're on Linux, you probably already have it installed. And the last Mac person who took this workshop, I think also already had it installed by default. But for Windows, you know, just search git-scm and the first result will be the right thing. So let's skip that stuff. So before you do anything in Git, you will need to like configure who you are, or else it will start complaining about, I don't know who you are. Because as it records the changes you make, it records who is making those changes. And all it wants to know is your name and your email. These don't need to be real names or real emails. They can be completely made up. A lot of like graphical front ends will just like use the name of your computer, which is kind of annoying sometimes, in that it'll just be some randomly generated number. But for the purposes of using GitHub, your username should be your GitHub username. And your email should be the email you signed up to GitHub with. Because GitHub will look at that information in the commits and actually associate those with your account. So if you want to run those right now, who's on Windows and... Oh, yeah. Who's on Windows? Raise your hand.
Here. Okay.
Is anyone on Linux?
Raise my hand.
Wow, really? Is anyone on Mac? Okay. So Mac people, do you know how to open up a terminal? Okay. Open up a terminal. Windows people, you want to open up git bash. Does everyone have that?
Git bash?
Yeah. Can I come back to you one sec, Parker?
Ease.
Okay.
I had downloaded a GitHub desktop, so I think I did the wrong thing.
Ah, okay. What happens if you just open the start menu and type git?
Okay. Let's try that.
Not in here.
Not here, okay. So, start.
Did anyone get, like, the terminal yelling at them or giving issues? Okay. So that stuff will tell Git who you are. By default, Git uses an editor called Vim, which is really awesome, but adds a learning curve. So I would say either set the editor to like Nano or like Notepad++. You should have all got an email about the slides, but if you didn't, ask me, I'll send you an email with the link to the slides in it.
So you say use Nano or Notepad for the easier one?
I would not use Notepad. So
okay.
Notepad does a very evil thing where if you have like line wrap turned on, it will just add superfluous line feed carriage return characters in order to do the line wrap rather than actually wrapping the line. and so it can do some very bad things without you realizing it. So I would use either Nano or Notepad++.
Sorry, I meant Notepad++. I apologize.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so use one of those two. Got it.
Yeah. And if you have git-scm, that should come with Nano packaged with it.
Okay. Which one do you like to use the most?
I like to use Vim, because I've already got over that learning curve.
Fair. Okay. Nano, then.
So
you said use it from the command prompt, right? Or use it from bash?
Use it from git bash.
Okay, got it.
Yes. What do you mean, nothing?
So,
So git config dash dash list just tells you all your configuration information. So there's a few different ways to make a repo. We're gonna go with the easier way. Is that too small? Maybe a little bit.
The text on the like slide is fine. The text in the pictures.
Yeah. I wonder if I can. That's going to take my laptop off the table.
It's not bad.
Okay.
That's worse.
So if you go to GitHub and you... So we want to create a repo. We don't want to clone a repo. Oh, right. Okay. So easy way that we'll do to begin with. All right, I'm already in Firefox. Is if we open a browser and go to GitHub, and we zoom out because I'm in a weird screen right now.
Is there any way you could screen share on Hangouts or no?
Oh yeah, shit, I didn't realize I wasn't screen sharing.
No, that's okay.
If I can, while I'm in tiny window mode.
No worries.
There we go. Okay, can you see that?
Yeah, excellent. Thank you so much.
Nice. So if we go to GitHub and make sure you can't see my password. What was it? Ugh. Not launching
on
Chrome. So there will be a thing on GitHub to make an empty repo. Uh, Okay, yeah, I'll just be slow and log in so I can actually show you what I mean. Okie doke. So on GitHub, on pretty much any page, you'll have like this little thing up here. And if you click on the plus sign, you can do new repository. And then it'll ask you, what do you want to call it? Do you want it to be public or private? If you just created a new account, you won't be able to create private stuff. Most of this doesn't really matter. So if you just do create repository, wait, I'm forgetting what the deal is with initial README. It will be a lot easier for you if you check the box to say, I would like an initial file in there. Otherwise, you'll need to do an extra step. So if you just create a repository, I'm not going to do it because I already have a junk repository. Where's Hello World? There it is. So once you create your repository, you'll have some page similar to this, but with a lot less stuff on it. And to get that locally on your machine, you need to go to clone or download, and then copy that URL. You do not want to download it as a zip. Downloading it as a zip will only give you the current state of the repository. It won't give you the full history and all the extra Git information. So you copy that link, and then I've already actually got it cloned, so I'm going to just ignore this a second. So we've just copied that link. And now we're finally gonna like run a command. So we're gonna go to where we want to put our repo. So this is like the first command line stuff we need to do. So if you just opened your terminal, you probably have something actually here. You probably have something that looks like that, right? Something that's just like your username at the name of your computer, and then like a tilde, or something saying like your home folder, right? You probably don't want to just clone everything to your home folder, because it just gets to be a mess. So we want to move from where we are to somewhere else. And the command to do that is cd, stands for change directory. So if I'm in my home folder and I do cd documents, now I'm in the documents folder. And I'm being told that by this little thing up here. Let's say I didn't know exactly how to spell documents. I could do ls for list, and that would list the different folders that I have. So then I could do cd documents. I could also just start pressing doc and then press tab, and it would auto-complete it for me, which is convenient. So once I'm in the place where I want to clone my repo, I'm going to type git space clone, and then I'm going to paste in that URL. most terminals will not interpret Control-V the way you think they will. Control-V will actually, like, escape a character. So if you wanted to type, like, a literal enter sign, or if you wanted to type a literal, is it normally carriage return? No, it's normally line feed. If you wanted to type like a literal line feed, you could do Control V and enter. That's the way the world worked pre-graphical interfaces, and it's just kind of stuck around. So long story short, most terminals you'll just do like right click, paste, rather than Control V. So once you hit enter on this command, it will grab all that information from GitHub. And now we will have a folder called Hello World that we can go into. And it has all the contents that our Hello World repo has. Let's go back to the slides. Whoops, that's not the slides. Is that how I share? Nope. Okay. So that's how you'd create a repo using github.com. The other way to do it would be to initialize a repository on your machine. Other thing about using bash, if you want to go up a folder, you just do cd space dot dot. Dot dot just means the folder above the one I'm talking about. So I could, for example, do cd dot dot slash, and then the renamed version of this to go up and then down over into Hello World, if that makes sense. And cd space minus just takes you to the last location you were at. Both kind of convenient commands. And cd space tilde takes you to your home directory, which is handy. So say you had, I'm just gonna make a folder, so you would need to make a folder and then initialize it as a Git repository. You could totally just do that for your normal file explorer. Like I could go to documents and then create new folder. And then I could go cd into example one and do git space init. And that would create a Git repository. And there's nothing in it except for some hidden files that are like the Git history. If I wanted to see those hidden files, I could do ls-a. Dash A is just the option for all. And so dot just means the folder that I'm in. Dot dot is the folder above me. And dot git is the hidden folder that contains the history. It's just named example one. So the name of the repository isn't actually part of that dot git history.
Right. So it would, when you do the git init, the repository that you're creating takes on the name of the folder that you're creating.
The repository basically just is the folder.
Yeah.
And you can still do git init on a folder that already has stuff in it. It won't change anything that's already in there. It'll just create that .git directory.
Does that mean that if you had stuff in that folder and then you did git in it, it would create a repository with everything in that folder?
No. Okay. You would need to create a commit with them, with the things that were already in that folder.
So, would...
No, it will consider those files as untracked until you add them to a commit.
Okay.
We'll get to that later.
Okay. Just is that different than if I created a new document in the folder? Would that be like tracked? Still untracked until I
can. Right. So if you initialized an empty directory and then made some files in it, that would be the same as having a directory that already had files in it and then initializing it.
Okay, cool.
So I'm changing directories to go up and then back down into Hello World. So that's cloning and initializing. Let's get to actual Git stuff. So the big four commands that you really care about are clone, pull, commit, and push. Clone just takes a repository that exists somewhere else and grabs that whole history, that whole repository. And will give you the files in like the current working state of that repository. Pull means that you already have the repository and you're in it, but you want to go get some of the changes from somewhere else and apply them to what's on your machine. Commit says you've made some changes to the repository on your machine and you would like to be able to tell other people about them. So you're adding them into a little nugget that gets added to the history. And push says, I have some changes that I've committed. I've added them to the history, and I would like to share them with other people. I would like to send them to some repository elsewhere. So for pretty much everything for the rest of this presentation, we'll have these little diagrams of the history. So stuff in this direction is the past, and stuff in this direction is the future, and would be like where we are now. And each of these dots is called a commit. And each commit like points to the previous thing. So this diagram is kind of implying that there's more stuff in the past that we're just ignoring right now. And this history, remote colon, we're saying that this is somewhere else. This is not where we are. This is our local machine. And that's the remote and local is a terminology that's used within Git itself and used within the documentation. So those are terms that are worth remembering. And so I think you probably get the gist at this point, but clone just says, I've got all this stuff, bring it all here. Pretty straightforward. Commit is where it starts to actually get interesting. So we have our local history and we've got some files that we've changed or files that we've created. And then we do git add with those files. Those files will be ready to be created into a commit. And then once we finally do git commit, those files that we added will get turned into a commit and added to the history. So let me give an example of what that actually looks like. So what files do I have? Let's just do README. So I'm gonna just throw some changes in here. What changes should I make? So I'm gonna save my file. I'm gonna quit. Yeah. Vim shenanigans. Don't worry about it. So if I opened it in a normal text editor, I could just make some changes to the file. So I've added two lines. Let's change a line. And then let's save it. So right now I have changes to my file. The way I can check that there have been changes to my file is I can do git space status, hit enter, and it'll give me all this information. There's a lot of stuff there, but if you just kind of read through it and think about what it's saying, it will eventually make sense. Branches, don't worry about just yet. Master is just like the default branch. Saying it's up to date with origin slash master, which means that the remote, which has just been named by default origin, which is GitHub, has, as far as we know, has all the same information that we have. And then it's, you know, giving us some tips about what we could do next. And it's saying that we've modified the file called readme.md, but that we don't have any changes to actually commit. So if we want to commit those changes, we can do git add readme.md, and you know there weren't any errors, so it didn't complain at us. It just didn't tell us anything. So now if we do again, git status, it's giving us a different message. We're still on master. We're still up to date with origin slash master, but now we have changes that are ready to be committed. They're what's called staged changes. So if at this point I do git commit, it will come up with my default text editor and ask me to describe the changes that I'm making. And it gives you a little plain English description of how to make that description. So TLDR, so the very first line is going to be your short description. This is really handy when you're like viewing the whole history of a thing, because you can kind of at a glance tell what a change is doing. If you write a really, really long line for your short description, most things will just truncate it. That'll just be a little ellipsis at the end. All the information will still be there, but it'll be more obnoxious to see. The long description has a blank line after the short description, and then it's just you type stuff. And as long as it doesn't start with a pound sign, it will make it into the description. Anything that starts with a pound sign will just get ignored. So if I save this and quit, Git will again not complain, and I do git status, and I see that I'm now ahead of origin slash master by one commit. So initially, well, yeah, I can just go back to the slides. Initially, I made my changes, and they were just kind of dangling off in front of the history. I staged them so that it would know which changes I wanted to commit, because you could imagine that I could change multiple files, but only want to commit a few of them. And then I said, okay, my staged files are good, I want to commit them. And so I did git commit, and that added those changes onto my history. Polling, kind of described it before. You have your remote machine. In this case, it'll pretty much always be GitHub. But it could be like another machine on a network. It could be a different directory on the same machine. It could be a USB stick. The remote is just a location where a repository lives. So you have your remote, and it's got extra stuff on the end of the history that your local repository does not have. And git poll says, I want those changes, and I want you to apply those changes. There is a subtle difference between getting the information about the history and actually applying it to your local repository, but we're not going to worry about that yet. So as long as you only have one remote to worry about, git poll will just grab the default. So don't worry about this command, but if I list my remotes, I only have origin. So if I were to do git space poll enter, it would just say you're already up to date, there's nothing new to get. I guess I'll show a demo of a poll later on. Push is basically the opposite of a poll, right? Should be pretty self-explanatory. Where you have a remote machine, it doesn't have the same history you have. You have extra stuff that you just want to tack on to the end of its history. And so you do git push, and then it's updated with that information. So right now, if I do git push, it's going to do annoying things. Ignore this. How do I spell hello? There we go. Change URL? Oh well. Let's not worry about it right now. This will just be another opportunity to drill the process into your head some more. dang it, that's also HTTPS. I'll use this as a different kind of loop learning opportunity. So getting information about your commands is a thing that you would like to do, right? Most commands, if you just end them with like dash H or dash dash help, it'll give you information. So if I do git remote help, it'll give me a bunch of stuff. Oh, this actually came up with the manual. That's funny. I think the Windows version, if you do dash dash help, it will just open a web page that has the man page. Linux has this whole thing of man pages, which are just like a more verbose version of help text, that would normally be accessed like this. Right? It's supposed to stand for manual. But anyway, it's supposed to be a more kind of consistent way of getting help for stuff, because some commands it'll be dash H, some commands it'll be dash dash help, some commands will be other weird stuff. And so it's more consistent to just say man. Oh, I want to rename it. Wait, do I want to rename it? Oh, there we go. Okay. Now if I push, so the default is to just use HTTPS, which means you have to enter your GitHub credentials. It's an easier way to do it, and it's marginally less secure than like SSH, but SSH has a learning curve, so I would say just use HTTPS until you're comfortable trying something new. So I've pushed my changes to GitHub. If I do git status now, it'll say that I'm up to date and I don't have anything I need to commit. And if I go over to GitHub and I refresh the page, then we can see I made a commit about 9 minutes ago. And it's the same, if we can actually see it on the dang projector, right? It's the same description, and if we go look at that commit, you can see a little visualization of the changes that got made. So we changed a word and we added some lines. So that's pushing. If you have multiple remotes, there are other ways to specify which remote you're pushing to, and you would get that information from the man page or from the help text. There's kind of this weird, let me actually zoom out a bit so you can see the way that would normally look. There's this kind of funky syntax for specifying how commands are input. Basically, stuff in square brackets is optional, and this little vertical pipe symbol means or. So these are some optional arguments, and I can use one or none of them. This might be a bad example because there's only optional arguments. Simpler command would be something like mv for move. It just renames a file from one location to another. Where these are like mandatory arguments, where you have to give it the name of where it's moving from, and you have to give it the name of where it's moving to, and there's space for optional stuff. You kind of get the gist of it by just reading a few different man pages. Let's make that text bigger again so it's easier to read. Is that? Seems reasonable. So other useful stuff would be status and log. You already know about status. Just tells you what's going on. When in doubt, just type git status, because that's kind of your eyes. Git log lets you look at the history. And by itself, git log is a little bit ugly and hard to tell what's going on. This big garbage number at the top of each thing is the hash for that commit. It's basically a random number that is tied to those changes. So if you made slightly different changes, you'd get a completely different number. And that's just used to uniquely identify a commit. So if you need to do stuff where you're pointing at different commits as arguments for a command, like that hash is what you'd use for it. And you don't really ever need to specify the whole thing. You really only ever need to specify like the first 4 or 5 characters, and Git will figure it out if it uniquely identifies it. So git log tells you who made the change, what's their email, when did they make the change, what's the description, what's the hash. And it will open it in what's called a pager. This is more Linux-y world learning curve. A pager is just yet another command line program that lets you scroll through files. So if I press down, I can scroll through the file. And if I can press up, I can scroll through the file. And if I press H, it will tell me how to use my pager. This pager is called less, which is pretty much the default for most everything. So if I, for example, press J and K, I can also scroll through. And to get out of here, I just press Q. A much more useful version of git log is git space log space dash dash graph. And that will give me a little colored line showing what the structure of that history is. So right here, it's showing that two independent branches of the history kind of merged together with the green line and the orange pumpkin-y line. So for like really complicated structures, you can figure out what's going on with the dash dash graph option. Oh wow, we're only an hour in. So branches. This is where it kind of gets interesting. So I forget, what is this slide saying? So we're on branch master. So this is all talking about stuff on our local machine. We're on branch master. Head is referring to what commit we're on right now. I have my own little alias that adds extra options to git log. You can see this commit has a bunch of like labels associated with it. One of those labels is head, one of those labels is master, more of those labels are origin slash master and origin slash head. So all of those labels are applying to just this commit. Head is a special one in that it just means what you are on right now. So if I were to do the command git branch dev, that would create a branch called dev, but it would be empty. So I'd have one branch here called dev that's just got nothing in it, and have another branch here called master. And then, if I made some changes and committed them, the structure would look like this. I don't know why that line is fainter. Is that visible at all? There's supposed to be a faint gray line there. Oops. Yeah, it's visible here. But basically, there's a line connecting these two things. So this commit is pointing back to this commit. This commit is also pointing back to it. But this one's on master, and this one's on dev. So if I show that over here, and let's edit README again. If I do git status, I can see, you know, there are changes that I haven't added. I do git add README git status. Now those changes are staged for commit. I do git commit describe the changes I've made. And then do git status one more time. My branch is ahead of origin master. Oh, damn it. I didn't actually go on to dev. Yeah, why did I never fix this slide? I knew this was wrong. One sec. Where am I? So what I was supposed to do is actually check out that branch. So git branch and then the name of the branch only creates the branch. It doesn't move you there, which is kind of obnoxious. So if I do git checkout dev and do git status, now I am on dev, right? If I wanted to go back to master, I could just do git checkout master. There is a better way to create branches that won't leave you forgetting this all the time. If you do git checkout dash b, the dash b option just says, I want to check out a new branch. I want to create a branch and then check it out. So let's just call it dev2. And let's edit README again. So, oh yeah. Accurate. So git status, I've made my changes, git add the file that I've made changes to. Eventually you can kind of stop typing git status all the time because you know what's going to happen, right? And I commit those changes. Hopefully you don't do, yeah. I'll make an actual message. So git status again, and now I've actually added stuff to dev2. So if I were to do git log graph, I'm also going to add the dash dash all so that I get the whole history, including branches that I'm not on. So this got I really need to fix that slide. That is very wrong. Oh well. Commits go on different branches. So changing branches, if you already had something, I think you kind of got the gist of this from what I was just doing, right? That if you have different branches, you can switch between them by using checkout. So it doesn't actually change the history, it just changes the files that are in the working directory. So where's hello world? So everything except for the .git folder is like what is checked out when you switch between branches. The whole like history of the repository is stored in .git, and you can apply those changes in the history to everything else by using the different git commands. I guess important tangent. You can go into the .git directory and mess around with this stuff, and that will you will rapidly descend into hell. In that these files are how git keeps track of what's going on. And if you mess with them, it will get confused, and you can, like, make irreversible changes and damage to the stuff you're working on. So, rule of thumb, just don't ever mess with the .git folder. There are no real benefits to it, and it can make everything horrible. So, merging branches is another kind of neat thing. So let's say, for example, you were working on a thing and you wanted to try an experiment and you weren't sure if you wanted to like actually keep those changes in your like official version of the thing you're working on. You could make a branch, play around with those changes, and then later keep working on your main thing. So you've like diverged those two like paths of stuff you're working on. And then even later on decide, oh, I do like those changes, I want to reincorporate them into my project. You could merge those two branches so that then you would have the experimental changes and like the official changes together in the same thing. So I'm going to use my alias to see what's going on. So right now, I'll just diagram this for you so it makes a little more sense. So right now what I have is I have a commit on master and then another commit on dev. So So what I would like to do is make a demo of a merge commit. So what I need to do is I'm on dev right now. Right, the head commit is the latest one on dev. What I want to do is check out master and then make some make some changes on master, commit them so that now my head will be here, and then I'm going to do a merge between these two. So quit that, git status, I'm on dev 2, so I'll do git checkout master, and then I'll make some changes. So just edit the readme again. One thing you can do if you get confident with stuff is git commit dash a, and that will just automatically add files that already appear in the history that have been changed. Marginally convenient. So, describing my commit, saving and quitting my text editor. So now, if I look at the history, I've got this little thing that I'm on, and I've got this thing that's branched off of it, that's on dev 2. So this is on one branch, and this is on another branch. So the next thing I'm going to do is git merge. And what that is going to do is create a commit on the branch I'm currently on that will point to two different commits and will incorporate the changes from those commits. So I'm on master, and I want to merge in the changes from dev 2. So I'm going to do git space merge space dev 2, and it's going to complain because both of those branches made changes to the readme file. Sometimes you'll have branches that don't have conflicting changes, like they'll be modifying completely different files, or they'll be modifying different lines of the same file. Sometimes the changes will be close together in the same file, or like modifying the exact same line, and git will say, I'm not a human, I don't know what changes are good and what changes are bad. You need to tell me which ones to keep. And so it'll make changes, it'll add in some little markup stuff to that text file to tell you where those conflicting changes are. So if I open up that text file, I've got this weird mess here that says these are the changes on head, and then I've got the changes. And then I've got a big old bunch of equal signs separating the changes between the stuff I had and the stuff that I was merging in. Then I've got some more changes. These are the changes from dev 2. And then I've got this final little delimiter saying those changes above me are the things for dev 2 and the rest is not. Anything after is not conflicting. So I need to choose which ones I want. So let's say let's say I just want to keep them both. You know, you could imagine if this was code, you would have like opinions about which ones to keep or like how to kind of incorporate them together, right? But for now, I'm just going to keep them both. Oh yeah, quit the text editor. So now if I do git status, it's like, okay, the last thing I know about is that both of these were modified and you need to fix it. So I know that I've fixed it, and so I'm going to do git add readme, git status, and it's going to say, okay, I'm ready to put this in a commit. And so I'll do git commit, and it'll automatically come up with this message saying, this is just a merge of two branches. And most of the time, that's a perfectly acceptable commit message. But if there's complicated stuff going on, obviously you should like opt to describe it. So if I do status again, I'm good. I've just added a bunch more commits. And if I look at the history, I now have this kind of triangular structure, right? Where these two things diverged away from this, and then they got merged back together with this thing. So that's merging. And again, most of the time you won't have to resolve conflicts like that. It'll just say, okay, I can merge them and there's no problem. So this is basically what we just went through, is conflicts. And the way we did this in the first workshop was like trying to describe what was happening in the terminal just through slides, and it was terrible. So that's all of the basics, really, is like cloning, pulling, committing, well, you know, changing, adding, and committing, and pushing, and then if you need to, merges. Should probably talk about conflicts with remote stuff. So right now I have stuff that is ahead of origin master. If I were to go over to GitHub and make some changes to something. But.txt. So you can edit files within GitHub, which is pretty handy sometimes. Like if you just need to make some quick change and you're not at your normal computer, right? So I just edit the file and then it'll want me to describe those changes. And then I can just commit them from my browser, which is kind of nice. If I go back to my terminal and I do git status, it still thinks the same thing. As far as my computer knows, nothing has gone on with the remote repository. It's the same as it was last we checked. So if I were to try and push now, and this happens a lot when you're working in a project with people where you're all pushing to the same branch, is that you pulled, you made some changes, and while you were making your changes, somebody else pushed. And so you need to get their changes before you can push. So if I do git push, And the text wrapped weird, so it's kind of obnoxious to read. But basically it's saying, no, you can't. And it's giving me the hint that I need to do git pull in order to actually get the changes that are on the remote. So I do git pull, as long as you've committed your changes, they're basically bulletproof.
Okay.
Unless you go fucking around in the .git folder.
Yeah. That's the one thing that always freaks me out. When I end up, like, copying all my files to, like, a random desktop folder because I'm so paranoid.
Right. Then it can kind of get weird.
Okay.
And especially with non-text files, like SolidWorks files, the best answer I can really give is just read the man page for git merge, and have your own branch that you work on. So like dev underscore Marie, it's kind of likely that nobody's going to push to dev underscore Marie other than you, right?
Can I keep, does that branch stay live, essentially? Like, if I said master and local, master, local, and then if I'm going along and I make a dev, and then I want to merge with the master, is the dev sort of just, like, stick with the master?
No. So
would it be like super behind?
Yes.
Oh.
There's a really easy way to deal with that though. So let's say this down here is master. And you branch off and do some work on dev. And then later on, I'm going to run out of space, aren't I? Later on, you make a merge between dev and master. And then people start doing work on master again. And then you check out dev, and you do some work on there. It'll be like that.
Okay.
And so to get these changes onto dev, you would check out dev and do git merge master.
Oh.
And that would do this.
Okay.
So the thing to remember about merge is it's taking something from somewhere and putting it where you are. It's not taking what you have and putting it somewhere else.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
So merge happens on your local machine.
Yes. Yeah. And more to the point, it happens on whatever branch you're on. So I'm just going to accept that message. So when I pulled, it automatically did a merge, and it didn't find any conflicts. It would get more annoying if you pulled and there were conflicts, because you know, then you'd unexpectedly be needing to, like, deal with conflicts.
Now, did you just check out dev or master?
Right now I'm on master, and I've... Let me diagram it out. So I'm on master, and I've got some changes, and I'll give these really simple hashes. A, B, C, and then the remote is also on master. And it's got, shoot, I should have put that further away. Oh no, oh no. So local and remote just have this simple linear history, but the most recent commit on each one is different. And so when I pulled, it grabbed commit D, which the part of the nature of commit D is that it must point back to commit B. Whoops. And it created a merge between the two. So that's what happened when I pulled from the remote, is it automatically created this merge commit. And the changes in D and C weren't conflicting, so it just automatically merged. If they were conflicting, what I would suggest is, well, the easiest suggestion would just be to commit to your own dev branch to begin with, right? So that you don't have to deal with making unexpected merges when you pull stuff.
Yeah.
Another way to do it would be to, like, rename master to like dev underscore oh no and then like make another branch called master that just gets the stuff from the remote.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Yeah, so the TLDR is to not have everybody committing to master, which is, you know, marginally more learning curve, but can save you a lot of headache. So advanced things is kind of what I was just talking about. Different strategies for doing branches. So for, like, big projects, it'll be... And I know that's... too small to read. It's too small to read on my screen, too. You'll have branches for, like, different levels of completeness. So you'll have, like, a release branch, which is, like, versions of things that you are willing to send out to people. And you'll have, like, a testing branch, where you only put completed things into the testing branch, and things only move from testing to release once they've passed all the tests. Stuff like that. But there's a bunch of different ways of to do it, and it's basically whatever you prefer. Features in Git. So there are things in Git, or sorry, things in GitHub that are additional to the built-in stuff of Git. So what GitHub has, oh right, I'm already in Chromium, is a way to track bugs. So if I go to this is a repo I work with a bunch. Sorry, the colors are kind of messed up right now. Let's see if I can turn that off. The horrors of not using my default browser, because I don't know how to turn that off. But anyways, there's a bunch of things that are like separate from the Git history. It's basically just like a little forum thread where someone starts out by describing a problem, and they might like tag it with different things like, how bad is the problem? What does it involve? So that someone can come in and look at the issue list and kind of assess, can I help with this? Is this important? Is this a thing that's already been solved and I can close the issue? Stuff like that. To help you manage the project. You can also add wikis to repos. A wiki is secretly just another repo. I can't think off the top of my head of repos with wikis. I actually don't like the wikis. I think it's kind of a dumb system. I think just put the documentation in the repo itself, right? But it's a place where you can just dump a bunch of markdown files. I guess that's a thing I should talk about too, is markdown. And the difference between repos and organizations. So I have my account that's just like github.com/jodang, and like there's a bunch of repositories that just are mine, right? There are things that I work on that are only associated with my account. There's also organizations, and there are a bunch of repositories that can belong to an organization. And anyone in that organization can commit to those repositories. As opposed to my own repositories, I would have to go individually give people permission if I wanted them to be able to push to my repositories. I guess I should talk about Markdown. So in a repo, if you have a file that's called readme.md, this is the only file they have.
No, actually, speaking of real quick, the repos, right? So speaking of saying, like, us in the PSAS one, right? Where we're going to be having all of our repos that we can add, that would be that.
Yep. Yeah.
I was thinking about just using the old recovery repo to build on that, because it was recovery under LB3.
Yeah. It's a matter of style.
Yeah, I didn't know if you're trying to generalize anything.
I'm actually still conflicted over whether these should be separate repos. I think they should both be called LV3, and they should have one branch for 3.0 and one branch for 3.1.
Yeah.
I've gone back and forth between that opinion. tags are another way to handle that. So there's a command called git tag that is closely related to a branch, but a tag only ever refers to one commit. It's not like a branch where that label just slides to the latest thing each time. Yeah. So whatever commit you're on, if you just do git tag and then a name of the tag, and then look at your history, it'll have that tag on there as another label. And you can actually use that to like check stuff out. So if I did, well, it'll complain that I'm already there. Oh, I guess it technically doesn't complain. That's funny. Anyways, yeah, tags are a nice way of keeping track of stuff. For example, this is the repo for the rocket airframe for PSAS. If I look at... GitHub calls them releases rather than tags, but they're just tags. This one has a tag for the April launch. That's one funny gotcha about tags. Tags do not automatically get pushed to the remote when you push. I think it's git push dash dash tags. Yeah, so if I go over to the website, and I look at the releases, now I have got a tag called ASDF that was just made. But if I just did git push, that wouldn't show up here. If I just did git push, it would only be the tags that were already here.
Oh, so you could have pushed in between those, and if you don't assign the tags, you won't see them on the list.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
So another example would be the ORSAT structure has like one tag for when we sent it off to get machined, and tags for the different versions of the satellite. And GitHub will actually allow you to come in and add more stuff to a tag. It'll allow you to add like these whole big comments to the tag and images, which is kind of nice for keeping track of the history of a thing. Although, there's an argument to make that this should go in like the documentation in the repo, right? View present. So, what else? These are the commands that are kind of like your eyes and ears on the command line. If you're on Linux, man is really useful, but if you're just on Windows, just add dash dash help to the end of something. Git status tells you what's going on in the repo. LS lists the contents of the directory you're in, and CD changes directories. Let's see. Personally, I think Git is super useful for my own projects, even when I'm not working with other people. Just because, you know, there's that whole thing of naming all your files version 1, version 2, version 3, version 4. And just having a couple commands that you can quickly type and not have to worry about what counts as a major version, what counts as a minor version, or like needing to merge things together, or like the fact that my directories will very quickly fill up with a mess of things that have almost identical file names, right? It can be pretty handy. I think I mentioned earlier a remote could also just be a file location. It could be a directory on a USB stick. So it's actually a handy way to manage working on the same project across multiple machines. Because I can work on stuff on my laptop, work on stuff on a computer at school, work on stuff on a computer at work, and not need to coordinate them together until I have to coordinate them together. And I just go around, plug a USB stick into one, git push, plug a USB stick into the other, git push, plug a USB stick into the other one, git push. And then all that work is coordinated. Oh, that's my last slide. Do you guys have questions about stuff? I know it was a little information fire hosey. You just kind of have to get used to it. I mean, sorry, not what I meant. The idea with this workshop was to just show you what's available to you. And once you get a chance to sit down and make changes to your own work and just try using Git, you'll get the hang of it. Don't be afraid to just have a sticky note that says, like, add, commit, push. And don't be afraid to use the help text or the man pages, because they really are meant to be used like a manual. Like, the best use of the manual page is not to sit down and read the whole thing. The best use is to have a general idea of what information is on there, and then just bring it up for 5 seconds. Oh, that's the syntax, now I remember. And then close it and type the command. Is Parker still with us? No. We have George and Parker, though.
What?
Oh, I was just curious if you guys were still there.
I had to leave for a few minutes because I had to go talk to the UTEEP group real quick, and then I just came back.
Cool.
I'm not presently here.
That's about it. there is a set of slides for an advanced workshop, which I haven't really ever taught yet, just because I think the information in these slides is like more than enough, and you'd need time to like process it and get used to it. Most of the stuff in the advanced slides is just more tips and tricks on branches. Because, like I was saying with Marie, you can get by with just everybody pushing to master, except when there's obnoxious changes that you don't know how to deal with. And then it really, really helps to actually use branches. But it's a lot better to get comfortable with Git and make your learning curve as shallow as possible while not, like, just copping out and using the GUI. Because you won't actually be able to, like, snowball your knowledge if you're just doing everything through the graphical interface. Because you won't really... I want to say you probably won't end up understanding what the buttons you're pressing are doing, because you don't have to, like, open the man page all the time.
So would you advise us to initially start just by using our own branches then, if you were in our shoes, like on the Captain team, or regardless if you have other people?
Yeah, totally. If everyone just uses a branch called dev underscore your name, and then when you want to share work between each other, you merge in the stuff from their branches to your branch. And when you have stuff where you're all like, this is great, we want to all use this, then one person merges it into master. When you're making your branch, it's git branch, and then the name of the branch. That will just create the branch, that won't check it out. So you need to do git branch dev my name, and then git checkout, dev my name. Development.
Okay.
It doesn't need to start with dev underscore. It could be anything. Those are all the questions. I'm just going to stop the recording. Yeah, thanks for coming out, everyone.
I'm sure I'll have a ton of questions for you once I actually try to do something.
Yeah.